Well, the topic of my report is barriers to desocialization in the USSR, and today it looks like these barriers are so high that the process of desocialization, it's even impossible to say that it's going slowly, it's just practically non-existent right now, because to my mind, the main barriers and the barriers are the vested interests in the Soviet bureaucracy, which I think they're behaving the same very way as Ludwig von Mises described in his excellent book on bureaucracy, and which was later also, well, the new features been described by Yugoslavian political activist and political scientist Milovan Gilas in his new class. They're controlling actually all fields of economic activity, if some of the fields are still existent in the Soviet Union. After perestroika, which started from the April 1985 with a so-called historic plenary session of the Central Committee of the Party, where Mr. Gorbachev first suggested the package of reforms known as glasnost, acceleration, perestroika, and so-called radical economic reform, since that time, the situation in national economy has been constantly deteriorating. Because of the complete absence of reliable economic statistics, you cannot even measure the depth of the crisis in which right now the USSR is in. Because, about a month ago, I had a lunch here in Washington with leading Soviet economist Abela Ganbigyan, who was a member of the so-called inner circle of Mr. Gorbachev and practically been his private tutor in economics. He estimates that, for example, last year economic growth was negative, it was minus 5%, while my former supervisor, Deputy Prime Minister of the USSR, Mr. Balkin, he thinks it was negative but minus 1.1%, and the chairman of the State Planning Commission, which is called in the Soviet Union the headquarters of disaster, Mr. Maslikov, he thinks it's 5.5% positive. So that means just nobody knows. And in the absence of statistics, of economic statistics, certainly, it's very difficult to assess how difficult the situation they are in right now. Also, there are some indirect indicators, like, for example, last year I was a party to the project done by the USSR Department of Labor. It's called State Committee on Labor and Social Affairs. And they've tried to calculate something like CPI here. But instead of 417 entries to the average market basket of the family, they've took 277. But they faced the dilemma they couldn't do any kind of coherent index because 243 out of 277 been absent from the state stores. So you cannot trace the price for a non-existent commodity. So this are just the problems, I mean, of economic information. And that's why most of Soviet economists right now, they use social or vital statistics to place the country in its proper, proportion. And it looks like it's not only third world economy, but it's some regions of the country, at least, they look like 10 less developed nations by the United Nations standard. For example, in places like Chukotka, Yakutia, Karakalpakia, these are so-called autonomous republics in the Soviet Union, infant mortality rate is above 100 per 1,000 of live births. Life expectancy, for example, in Yakutia, where I've been last April, because still the statistics is not available on a national level, life expectancy for males was 48 years and for females 56. And about 100% of indigenous population of the northern part of Yakutia been infected with TB. So it just this kind of statistics place the Soviet Union, especially these parts, somewhere between Burkina Faso and Chad. And national statistics, vital statistics, also shows that the situation is rather desperate. It's 68th country in the world, according to the so-called weighted consumption basket. I do not believe in this weighted consumption basket but still that's the Soviets who calculate themselves. But still it's certainly not 65% of American GNP that Soviets has, as CIA or DIA want to convince us with. It's, to my mind, can be something like 11-12% of GNP, but again, it's just a guesswork, it's not statistics. Decades-long efforts in the Soviet Union to eliminate free market resulted in total or nearly total monopolization of economy, which is run by approximately 800 ministries. They have about 100 ministries in Moscow and 700 ministries in so-called sister republics. And, well, about 18 million of people, and that's the main barrier to perestroika, to this economic reform, to a free market, is the existence of this 18 million of bureaucrats who are not actually the civil service in American understanding of this term. If we shall apply American standard of civil service, they will have 109 million of people in civil service in the Soviet Union out of 119 million employed there. So these people are just the top of the iceberg. It's just this 18 million of people. And most of these people are employed by the central ministries, and certainly they're trying to block even the piecemeal reforms which Mr. Gorbachev suggested in 1987. The result of this, of their activities is obvious. It's just the so-called, irrational structure of the national economy. But it's not even irrational, it's just completely, as Ludwig von Mises put it, it's just the absence of economy in his great work, Economic Calculation in the Socialist Commonwealth. And right now, instead of moving forward with these reforms, they're just, all the time stepping back. On the 14th of December last year, the Supreme Soviet of the USSR blocked even the piecemeal reforms, although they would certainly be disastrous as well, but they blocked even these piecemeal reforms, and they've declared the program of so-called restoration of order. That means of restoration of the so-called centrally planned or command economy. And the idea is that they must first restore central planning, they must restore command economy, and then when they will have abundance of goods, I don't know where they will come from. Also, there are some indications where they can come from. Then to proceed forward towards the so-called socialist planned regulated market. Nobody actually knows what is it, and when my former supervisor, Deputy Prime Minister of the USSR in charge of economic reform, Mr. Abalkin, was asked what does it mean, this socialist market, he said something different than Odessa Bazaar. Odessa Bazaar is a very vivid and lively place, and I don't know what kind of socialist market he must have there, without goods or what. Moreover, there's a great problem, and that's also a great obstacle to perestroika. It's the problem of complete absence of economics, of economic theory, of economic thinking. For 70 years, modern economics was treated in the Soviet Union as a bourgeois vulgar political economy, and Ludwig von Mises and Hayek have been declared as the enemies number one there. Moreover, they haven't read even leftish Keynesians. I mean that they are ignorant, the economists there, not only of Ludwig von Mises, but say of John Robinson as well. They're trying also right now, there is a lot of discussions in Soviet economics, and they're trying to reinvent a lot of things which have been invented 100 or 150 years ago. Like, I was present to the Scientific Council of the Soviet Department of Labor, and where the guy just reinvented the Engel law. That means that the proportion of your income will drop with your disposal for food will grow, will drop with the increase of the income itself. And he actually tortured about 27,000 of people who, on a free of charge basis, been filling the forms to prove this kind of thing, and he was granted his PhD. Okay. So the problem with this kind of vested interests, they also are reflected in economic theory. And unfortunately, right here from the United States, a lot of very disturbing advices are going on there. For example, I made a copy of the Wall Street Journal, December 7, 1989, and the question here is a rhetorical question, can the Soviet economy be saved? And the answers are, the two answers which I suggested, maybe with tax reform. And another answer is not without U.S. aid. And unfortunately, Wall Street Journal is believed in the Soviet Union as some kind of a ruler of American imperialism, which now everybody loves there. And so unfortunately, I'm afraid that this kind of advice will be taken seriously there. And tax reform, to my mind, it's just, I mean, that if the country is, they just don't have anything to redistribute with these taxes. That's one thing. About USAID, it's just, again, it's they've spectacularly wasted a lot of money. They had, for example, Soviet Union, since 1981 to 1987, they had about $240 billion of dollars, not rubles, in revenues for oil and gas export. And nobody knows where this money are, because that's the government who just something like a dark hole for all the money there. Because, and also the absence of the goods there, it's just due to the, they've been wasted mostly on these spectacular projects like reverse of the rivers or construction of new Egyptian pyramids or something like that. Because imagine, it's still a dictatorship. I mean, that certainly Mr. Gorbachev is much better than the corpses been there before at power. But even him, himself, he is still a dictator, also, well, more charismatic one. But certainly any kind of dictator would be interested, say, in production of toilet papers, how he would be remembered by the generations to come. And certainly something like to reverse the rivers or to build new towns where nobody can live. That's the idea of that system. So that's the absence of economics. It's really, I mean, of competent economists, it's really, well, quite a disaster for the country. And I think the only kind of U.S. aid which I think must be provided and can be accepted there is to provide them with economic analysis, especially that provided on a good basis. And that's why I think that that Ludwig von Mises Institute and as well as other respected organizations here must provide this kind of expertise for the Soviets. Because right now it looks like they can just by chance have some wrong book, and after that they will try to implement it again like they've implemented the wrong book, which was called Das Kapital of Karl Marx. Still, this breaks for perestroika. I mean, these are bureaucrats. Who are them and why they are against reforms? The number of bureaucrats in the Soviet Union all the time is growing on. It's in 1970, for example, there have been only 13 million of people in bureaucracy there, while today it's more than 16% of the labor force employed are the leading bureaucrats. I mean that it's not again the civil service, it's just the upper level, something like starting from GS-15 here. So it's the greatest proportion in the world of the people in these higher echelons. For example, in China, they have only 27 million, but it's 5% of the labor force, not 16. The most active break for perestroika is about 500,000 people who are in party apparatus. This party apparatus, it's just something in itself, and these people are, well, have a lot of vested interests because they just don't know how to do anything else. And their main profession is just the ruining of the economy and redistributing the leftovers after. And this rationing cards, they're introduced right now practically everywhere. In Moscow, the first time since 1947, they've introduced rationing of sugar and butter, and it's the first time. And Mr. Gorbachev himself, he knows this situation because quite recently he remarked that The bus of war veterans came to Moscow, and that's, I'm just quoting him, and they had two pictures there on the bus. One was of Brezhnev with a lot of these orders and medals. He was so pleased to decorate himself with. And another was Mr. Gorbachev, who instead of these orders and medals had this rationing cards all around. And the problem there is that the economy is also managed vertically, so-called. That means that each industry belongs to some ministry. And this ministry is practically uncontrolled body, which is in charge of production of this and that, that things. And the creation, the idea behind this ministry was just something of very oversimplistic Marxist vision of management. That means if you don't have something, you just create a ministry and appoint somebody, say Comrade Ivanov, in charge of production, say, of vegetables. And if, and that's the real case, I'm not joking, it's 1979, somebody told Mr. Brezhnev there are no vegetables in the country, and immediately they created a ministry for vegetables, and Comrade Piotrowski was appointed a minister, and he was warned that if the vegetables will fail to appear before the 1st of September next year, he'll be relieved of his party membership card. That's their idea of how to run the country. Right now, unfortunately, Mr. Gorbachev is practically on the very same track. Moreover, the Council of Ministers of the USSR say 10 years ago they would usually adopt 500 to 700 decisions a year, which would be, again, fantastic. But right now it's 2 to 2.5 thousand of decisions, which nobody even can read. I mean, that's just volumes and volumes of, it also led to some kind of space crisis in the Library of Congress here. These decisions would be mostly on that, just like that, that no detergents, say, in Novy Ustian, and they will issue a special directive that the detergents must appear there before a certain date and would put somebody's name as a responsible person. But hopefully these persons, even whose names are listed, I think that most of them don't know about that. This bureaucracy, unfortunately, it's very costly. It's about 18% of national income, according to Soviet calculations. They are spent on so-called management, on mismanagement of economy. 18%. That's, according again to Soviet statisticians, that's about three times more than is spent for this ungodly purpose here. Also here, certainly, well, I was a little bit more optimistic about the absence of bureaucracy in the United States when I came. But it looks like, to some extent, the bureaucrats there can even have some lessons from here. Another problem which is facing is the problem of ideological vacuum. I mean that the problem that it's also a great obstacle to desocialization in the Soviet Union is that prevailing still is egalitarian mentality among the people. Also, this egalitarian mentality is all the time perpetuated deliberately by the government, but still a lot of workers and peasants think that everybody must have his equal share in the product. It led to the discontinuation of production of this product, but still a lot of people believe in this so-called social justice. And the roots are very deep and they go into the medieval times, I think, in Russia, because in Russia, that's why, by the way, Lithuanians, say, or Armenians or Georgians are doing much better than Russians economically. Because the Russian landholding was based on the so-called community property rights. And this, there have been rural communities who would own together land and pastures and sometimes even cattle. And this communal approach led to the widespread collectivistic mentality. That means that it's better to skim the milk all the time and throw the cream away. And that's what the Soviets have been doing. And the human cost of this cream, which was skipped and then thrown away, is about 42 million of people who have been victims to this collectivization, to this Leninist national policies and whatnot. Recently there was a letter published, for example, and the lady says that she, her neighbor earns much more and she lives nicely because she is raising the early vegetables, and I'm working on a state plant and doing poorly. And her conclusion is, I don't want to live like her, but I want her to live like me. And that's unfortunately the prevailing thinking of a lot of people. Then among the liberals, also there are two sections. It's European and American understanding of liberals. Some of them, I think the majority today are free market among the liberals. Also, there's still a lot of, unfortunately, still a lot of people who are charmed by the so-called Swedish experience. And for example, this Mr. Abalkin, who is considered to be very liberal there, he returned from Sweden and he said, they have the true socialism, we don't have socialism here. And that means that the idea behind Mr. Gorbachev's reforms today is to return back to the year 1919 and to start everything anew, but based on the so-called Leninist concept of socialism. And that makes a lot of people certainly very much unhappy. Then another problem is, besides this economic mentality, is the problem of how to privatize. Because today, about 60%, according to Mr. Aganbegian's estimates, about 60% of capital stock in the Soviet Union has negative or zero value. That means that since 1917, they haven't closed any single enterprise. And the technology is mostly obsolete. I've seen myself, for example, equipment produced by Krupp in 1904, and it's still operating. And most of Soviet enterprises, especially in heavy industries, such as something like industrial history museums. And it's very difficult to privatize the possible debts, as you can understand, because if the country would be open to the world economy, world competition, to my mind, it'll be not 60%, but much more, which would be closed. But again, that's the guesswork of Mr. Aganbegian, because when I asked him, how come 60%, he said, I think so. That's the way, unfortunately, the reforms are devised there in the Soviet Union. To privatize, but how to privatize, I think I will not actually repeat a great article by Murray Rothbard in a September issue of 1989 of the Free Market. And it is a very good comprehensive program, how to privatize and what to privatize. And well, to sum it, everything must be privatized and as soon as possible and at once. Because when the reforms go slowly, the bureaucracy can consolidate, and they do consolidate themselves. Then the people are very much disappointed with reforms because the government is now producing something on them like the Pavlov's dogs, some kind of reflex that when they say democracy, then detergent expires. When they say glasnost, then no sausages. When they say, and they associate this with reforms. They think that democracy, that means no sausage, no soap, no nothing. And unfortunately, there is a lot of groups which do perpetuate this kind of ideas. Today, there is a rather visible and vocal opposition on the very right. But unfortunately, you cannot claim them as free marketeers as well. Because Russia, before the revolution, was also over-bureaucratized and very statist empire. And these people belong to the so-called Pamet Society, which is anti-Jewish group, anti-Masonic group, and also nobody have ever seen Freemason in Soviet Union, but it's very easy to blame that you are Freemason and you cannot prove the opposite, I think, especially if some torture would be exerted on you. That's the way I think the Stalin operated, because everybody was declared, according to the international situation, a Japanese or American or German spy at that time. And so that's the problem, how to privatize. It's again, I think that Professor Rothbard is absolutely right that the property must be just homesteaded away to the people who've been robbed out of this property before. It's impossible right now to find out to whom this property belongs, say, before the revolution, but and most of the property being created during the last 70 years, So I think it must be just divided between the employees, and certainly this reform must be preceded or done simultaneously with the nationalization of land, because the situation in Soviet agriculture is even more desperate than anywhere else. Since 1929, since collectivization, about 102,000 of villages been abandoned, and I mean that still right now they are just staying like monuments, abandoned homes, like monuments to the socialist experimentation on living people. Izvestia, that's the government newspaper, recently reported that in Novgorod region of the Soviet Union, of Russia, they use the troops to milk the cows, because nobody is there to milk the cows. And so they moved the troops in, not to suppress the public movement, but just to milk the cows, because there's no public there. The problem, another problem, how to privatize again, is the problem of currency, because they don't have any viable currency right now. They use this Lenin's pictures, which have only nominal value of the portrait, and so it's terrible overhang of this of these portraits, and according to Soviet estimates, about 320 billion of these rubles are not supported by any kind of goods or services produced in the country. And that's why I do agree with Professor Habler that it's very interesting what kind of reforms been done in West Germany. Certainly the reforms, the content of these reforms is rather controversial. I mean that to some extent, I think that it's very difficult to apply economic systems of one country to another country without. But still, what they would need, certainly they would need a monetary reform. And I think the best kind of monetary reform would be that it must be based on the golden standard. So that's also a problem today, but I think this kind of problems can be done if there would be political will on behalf of the government to do these things. Quite recently, Mr. Gorbachev appointed new economic advisor, that's a session of this economic advisor is innumerable, Mr. Petrakov, who is actually an econometrician. But I know him, and it looks like, imagine econometrician in the Soviet Union. It's just by itself, it's a joke. I mean, how can you make an equation of party decisions, for example, or with the economy, with no feedbacks, with no market, you cannot make a model of that. It's just impossible. I mean, it's not an equation, it's something else. I mean, it's just only one part of equation all the time. And he suggested some reforms, some new reforms based on the Polish experience. But again, he said that we would not accept exploitation of one man by another, and it doesn't give any promise if he still uses this language. What they're trying to do right now, that's not privatization. They want to sell the unprofitable enterprises to the workers. It's just only unprofitable and to the workers and to sell. And that means that will be some kind of coercive action that the workers will actually pay some part of their wages for the shares they cannot trade even, they cannot sell them away. Maybe they can recycle them, as a lot of people are very, well, I think rather crazy here on doing this. So that's the problem they face in industry and in agriculture. Today it's because of the depopulation of a lot of rural areas, there are just no people even who would be happy to have the land. I mean, and because in the absence of the market, you never predict what the government would say next. And say there is a good comparison between the new economic policy of Lenin, who introduced it in 1922, and actually Professor Botke, he wrote, and it will soon appear, very good monograph on that. It's the best actually I've read on the Soviet Union in English. It existed since 1922 to 1928, And during these 6 years, they've just revived the dead body of economically of Russia, because they've reintroduced free market, they've introduced competition and everything. And at that time, the chief party economist was Nikolai Bukharin, whose views Professor Bodke describes in detail. And he put forward some kind of logo, get rich, peasants as workers, get rich. And those of it who followed then being exterminated 6 years later in the Stalin's camps, practically all of them. If you would be, for example, a stockbroker in 1927, and if you would put it in your registration form, you would be just automatically exterminated. And not only, well, say, fine, but it will be capital punishment usually. So today it looks like the idea behind the economic reforms is the same. Let us introduce some features of capitalism. Let us improve the state of art and the economy, and then we'll proceed further on with our beloved communism. And there is, well, at least there is such a, well, great danger in all of these reforms. Well, maybe I'll leave a couple of minutes for questions.
I take it from what you say that the Soviet Union is clearly on sliding downward. Do you think that it will come to chaos and that the government will collapse? There'll be civil war or something of that kind, and how soon do you think that will happen?
We had a Soviet delegation last week, and I've asked them, when you will discontinue to slide down? They said, when we will reach the bottom. and but right now, they said they're on this track. And well, the civil war, the problem with the civil war, that most of the civil wars in world history are based on envy. And in the Soviet Union, it's just, I would not imagine myself, well, who will fight whom. Because this party nomenclatura, for example, who enjoys some privileges, again, they are, well, comparing especially to Western standards and even to Soviet standards, they are not very well to do. I mean, the party nomenclatura people would have maybe sausage in the fridge and piece of soap in the bathroom. And certainly it's very easy to distribute it at once, but the problem is that will not solve the problem again. I think that will be national disintegration will go on, and the empire will go, well, in the next 5 or 7 years. And right now I'm so happy that we have here Kestutis Baltramaitis from the Lithuanian government, who is a participant in our conference. And this kind of process will go, because, and also there's very strong economic reasons behind that, because obviously for everyone that the boat is sinking economically at least, and everybody wants to jump out because it hasn't reached the bottom. So that's one case. Another case is that they will maybe find the right track, or maybe the track which would be not as far from the right there now, rather soon, because it looks like Mr. Gorbachev himself, he is all the time radicalizing. It's again, that's what's bad in the authoritarian state, that he has, for sure, he has some blueprint for the nation, but nobody knows it. What's it? Last September, he said, all talks about the multi-party system is sheer rubbish, just a quotation, so-called Eastern European free common market, but it's just when you just never know what's going beyond this charismatic birthmark, and that's why it's very difficult to predict the future. As Anthony Sampson once said, USSR is a country with unpredictable past, and so it's very, because they've been rewriting history all the time, so it's very difficult to say something definite. Also, the people, especially from this intelligence community here, who participated in the Slavic conference in Chicago recently, they are very good in production of different, on the federal pay, it's very, well, I mean, I think a lot of incentives to produce scenarios. And one guy produced 15 scenarios for the Soviet Union, which may be the cheapest way to produce, I mean, that he was the most efficient. And certainly anything from these scenarios can happen, but I don't think it will be civil war.
The immense disparity of the polar
capitalist, and the Russian market was the biggest market for the state now.
Mm-hmm.
So any kind of free trade agreement there, if there was one, would probably need a lot of preferred.
Oh yes, sure, but I think it's only in the very distant future, because right now there is no foreign trade in the Soviet Union. There is a so-called planned international circulation of goods, and they have the Ministry for External Economic Affairs, which I think secures about 92% of all imports and exports. And today, Comecon is going apart. I mean, this so-called Council for Mutual Economic Assistance, that's the so-called Eastern European Free Common Market, but it's just Eastern European Common, but not the market for sure. And it was because it was based on planned decisions by the Comecon headquarters in Moscow. And they've usually they would be rather good in at least in exchange of the goods between these countries, not in selling or buying, but in exchange of the goods between these countries. About the quality of these goods, they call themselves, the people from the Comecon headquarters, I have a friend there, he called it international rubbish exchange, because the quality is so poor and you cannot sell these things anywhere else. And that's why that's the problems today are facing Poland and especially GDR and Hungary, because rather great part of their export-oriented industry has been oriented to production of this rubbish for this exchange. And today the Soviets declared that they will go on dollar basis on this calculation since the year 1991, and that would be horrible for these people, because certainly the money will go, if the Soviets would have dollars, but I don't know where and how, to South Korea and Taiwan. And but it's not a free, not a trade though. Mm-hmm.
It's common that, as I understand, the unions are very big. Romania wants the oil and gas that the Soviets are no longer supplying, and it should pay it in dollars for it. But at the same time, the Soviet Union is perfectly willing to pay in rubles for what it's mining. So the union.
Yeah, well, that'll be fine if it'll be the case, I think, because it's. Fine. I mean, that certainly will be unfair from one point of view. But from another point of view, oil and gas are, well, the products you usually can dispose in the international market. And this exchange, I mean, between this of this low-quality products is actually not in the interests of Lithuanians or Poles or anyone else, because it just perpetuates the obsolete industries there and actually does not press so drastically for the real genuine economic reforms. And that's why, to my mind, this system must be eliminated. Just because anytime, I think that there is a certain proportion, I mean, not such a direct, well, relation between the level of government intervention and economic disaster. And if the government here commands about one-third of national income, it's just one-third of disaster. In Soviet Union, it's about 87%, so it's 87% of disaster, and the less, the better. And
you mentioned the backing of the ruble with gold. Do you have any sense for whether the Russians have any stockpile of gold? And the second question is: is there any thinking now in Russia with regard to backing the ruble, either with gold or with any hard currency?
Well, right now it's impossible. I mean, that to my mind, if you print Lenin on the ruble, it cannot be just never be convertible. The problem is that there is so many, this kind of reform must be also introduced in a package, and not like Wayne Angel or Alan Greenspan are trying to persuade Russians that they must introduce right now gold standard, especially Wayne Angel. Because in this case, there'll be another disaster. The gold will be immediately vacuum cleaned out of the economy. It will just go to the South Korea or Taiwan or somewhere else without serious political and economic changes, without privatization, the first thing. You cannot just do any kind of reform. There is another very interesting suggestion of, I think, Giudvanitsky, who thinks that maybe the currency reform can be done even on this basis, but he puts the horse before the cart, not after, like Mr. Angel, in the sense that he thinks that the privatization by itself will create the deflationary situation in the economy. And the deflationary policies can be pursued very efficiently in the country with practically no public debt, which is the main obstacle to deflate here. And this looks fine. I mean, but still, I think it's only take it or leave it. I mean, to have the whole package together.
We're going to adjourn now for lunch. We'll be back here at 1:30, and we'll have more chances to question Yuri during the panel. Thank you.